Hey there, Marshall here from Limited Resources, and well, normally I would say we're jumping into another draft with you here on Channel Fireball, but not today. Trying something a little different. This is my favorite constructed format. This is Canadian Highlander. I wrote an article about it on Wizards, and I think the best constructed format going right now. And I want to show it to you. I want to share this with you and see maybe if you at home are interested in building these decks and playing. I've got this. This is my deck that I have in real life, and I've built it on Magic Online as well. And this is it. So this is the breakdown on Canadian Highlander. And you know, real quick, it's 100 card singleton. So you can see I've got 100 cards. Of course, basics don't count towards that singleton. But minimum 100 card decks. It uses the vintage banned list. Now, if you know anything about vintage, you know that vintage does not ban cards unless they're like illegal. Like, and I'm talking about like they make you use an ante, or they use physical dexterity, which isn't supposed to be part of Magic, you know, Chaos Orb or something like that. Every other card though in vintage is legal. All the Power Nine, all the old stuff, the Mox and everything. So what they've done is absolutely genius, though. They made it 100 card singleton so that you get a varied play experience. But then you think, well, why doesn't everybody just play every Mox and all the Black Lotus and, you know, Time Walk and everything? All the decks are going to look the same, which is sometimes what happens in Vintage, where they restrict those cards, but you're allowed to play one of each. A lot of the decks just play, you know, a good percentage of those cards. What they've done is they made something called the Canadian Highlander Points List, and it's maintained by the Canadian Highlander Council. That's some folks up in Victoria, BC, who started and have been playing this format for 15, 16 years or something. It's been going forever up there. Super, super popular. They have tournaments at least once a week, and it's awesome. So the points list works like this. We get 10 points total to spend, and there's a list of cards. In fact, here, why don't I just bring this up for you so that you can see what it looks like as of now. Okay, so this is the Canadian Highlander website, okay? And this is where you can see the points list, okay? So these are the changes that they just made at the end of last year. And you can see that each of these cards has points. Now, as you can see, this list is actually quite short. That's all of them right there. There's, you know, whatever, 40 cards or something on the list total. Every other card, you can just play. It's legal, and you can do it, and it doesn't matter. But if you want to put Mox Sapphire or Mox Ruby or whatever into your deck, that's going to take 3 of your 10 total points. So you only get to spend 10 points total. So, for example, if I want to have 3 Mox in, that's 9 of my points, and then I could put, you know, Mana Drain or Mana Vault in my deck, and that's it. I don't get any more. And as you can see, they've heavily pointed cards that go against the 100 card singleton philosophy, which is varied gameplay. So you'll see a lot of the cards on the list are tutors. Here's Worldly Tutor, here's Vampiric Tutor, Demonics up here for 4. That's almost half of your total points on one card. You know, it happens to be one of the best tutors, of course. Personal Tutor. So you'll see that those ones go. Fast Mana is another one, right? These are just broken cards. Here's the Moxen. I mentioned Mana Vault. Black Lotus is 7 points, etc. Addition to that, completely broken cards. Cards that are just stupid or enable degenerate combos tend to pick up points. Cards like Balance. Balance is a broken card based on power level, right? Ancestral Recall just went from 6 to 7. It used to be 5. So and sometimes cards go down too as well. Time Walk, Time Vault, right? This is just a stupid card that's completely broken. These are the type of cards that pick up points. And so here's my deck. It's a Bug Midrange deck, or Sultai, or whatever you want to call it. And my points are, right as of right now, Treasure Cruise, which is 1. I absolutely cannot help myself. I'm playing Ancestral Recall if there's a format where I'm allowed to play Ancestral Recall. So there's that. And then that's 7 points, so that's 8. And then I've got, you can't see all my lands because the list gets a little long here, but I've got Library of Alexandria in here as well. There it is. Okay. And then my last point is Tainted Pact. And Tainted Pact is a tutor. And if you build your deck around it, it rewards you by basically just letting you go get whatever card you want. And this is a Bug Midrange deck that has a big finish with a Painter Servant and Grindstone that it can search up, but it also can just grind you out with value. So yeah, that's it. That's the deck. And I'm going to be walking you through. I'm going to be playing against my friend Adam, who actually just built a new Canadian Highlander deck, and I haven't really seen it. I've only seen a little bit of what he was doing. And we're going to play against it and see if he came up with something really sweet or if we're going to smash him. And I'll be teaching you that as we go through. So I'm going to get into that match, and we're going to be playing three matches today just to give you a feel for the format. And here we go. All right, we are in the match, and we have won the die roll. We're going to play. Highlander tends to play pretty quickly. You don't want to putz around too much. This is a little unfortunate to have both of these lands in our opener, but I'm going to keep because we've got Jace the Mind Sculptor and Preordained, so we should be able to kind of find some of what we need here. There is a full range of archetypes in this format. You know, you can play aggro, you can play ramp, you can play control, you can play combo, storm. There's a whole bunch of different stuff that you can do. And so that's pretty sweet. You can brew. There's a lot of different routes to take with it, and it's sweet. So let's start by preordaining here. I'm going to sleeve Flooded Strand for now. All right. So that is land number three, and then we can also flash this thing back, so that seems pretty good. We're going to draw that one. I'm just going to go ahead and play the forest and pass the turn. That lets us play the Hinterland Harbor untapped next turn if we'd like, and we can just immediately flash back Preordain, or if we want, we can even just cast Walking Ballista if there's something worth killing on the other side of the battlefield here. Ooh, Mind Stone, nice one. Yeah, I think I'm just going to snap back the Preordain right now. I kind of like the idea of just churning through our library a bit here and seeing what we can get. Sure, I'd rather Snapcaster back Ancestral or whatever, but we haven't drawn that. And I'm pretty glad we did this. I think I'm just going to bottom both of these. More lands at this point isn't really what we want, and we drew one anyway, so that's fine. And we'll see what Adam has lined up for turn four or turn three with four mana. If it's just some big dumb creature, we'll probably just chase bounce it. If it's really scary, we could just Damnation, losing our Snapcaster Mage, but we got value off of it. Oh god, that's really scary. Raphelos. And Adam already has two forests in play, so Raphelos taps for two right now. Ooh, that's a good draw. Abrupt Decay. So Adam could easily have a counterspell of some sort, which could lead to some disaster scenarios for us. So we could play Jace to bounce Raphelos, which would put us in a good spot. But if Jace gets countered, Adam gets to untap with at least 2, 4, 5, 6, and then maybe even 8 mana to just cast something absurd. So I could be a bit more conservative and just Abrupt Decay Raphelos. I also could go for Walking Ballista for 2 and just try to trade it for Raphelos to play around a counterspell, because if they have it, then I can just go for the Abrupt Decay. I'm really scared of Raphelos. I am terrified. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to attack first and offer the trade, because if they make that trade, then obviously I'm super stoked and it's never going to happen. But by the way, we've put the clocks up a little higher for this just because I told Adam, look, I'm going to be talking. So, you know, I don't want my viewers to have to feel like, you know, like I'm going to run out of time and that's how the thing ends or whatever. Also, this is kind of cool because if it happens to be Remand, then I can actually just recast it. All right, let's just kill that guy. It's a bummer to lose the Walking Ballista there, but I still think it's worth it to, we could just lose the game. Like, if Adam goes counter that, untap, spend something for 8 mana, we could just be done. You know, there's, you know, Karn, right? Like, they just play Karn, and we're like, well, game's over. Can't do anything. So, I think that's better. We have a lot of counter spells in this deck as well. But our goal right now is to get this on the battlefield. If we can get Jace down, then we're in good shape. And now I think I'm just going to go for it. I might even just go for Tezzeret here. Tezzeret is not the best card in our deck, but the reason I run it is because I have two things that it works well with, and this is common for Highlander decks, is you'll see packages of cards that go well together. So I run Trinket Mage. So I have a package of cheap cards that Trinket Mage can go search up, and Tezzeret can get any of those. So that's pretty cool. And then on top of it, my two-card combo is both searchable by Tezzeret and both one turn after the next. So I can, like, for example, I can play Tezzeret minus one to go get, grindstone, or minus two to go get Painter's Servant. And then the next turn I can minus the other thing, still have Tezzeret around, and get both pieces of the combo and then win. So I think I'm just going to go for Tezzeret here, because it is a devastating play if it resolves. And if it gets countered, I can always use Jace to generate a lot of advantage in the long term. So it looks like Adam did have Counterspell, though that wasn't what he was holding up before, because he had colorless and blue. So that's kind of interesting. Take your medicine. Okay, go ahead. So we're leaning on a couple of cards here. The Damnation as well. Like, if Adam's plan is to untap and play some big six drop that's really scary, but it's a creature that we can Damnation, then we can be fine with that. Captain Cissé. Search your library for a legendary card, reveal it, and put it in your hand. That is sweet. And Adam's left up counter magic again. Abrupt Decay doesn't work here, though. I could go for Damnation. I think I'm just going to go for Jace this time, though. Don't counter Jace, don't counter Jace, don't counter Jace. Yes, 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 yes. All right, so in this spot, let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, he could search up something insane. Yeah. Let's just bounce him. And I think I just leave Snapcaster back in case Adam has his own copy of Snapcaster Mage. Just, you know, flashes it in and just kills Jace. It's so not worth it for the 2 points of damage. Here I'm able to leave up both Mental Mist Up and Abrupt Decay, which is kind of cool, even though the truth is I still don't have an answer for Captain Cissé. And if Adam replays her, I'll probably just have to start brainstorming. I could bounce one more time, but that's not really getting me anywhere. I also could just Damnation and have Jace on the battlefield. Uh-oh. Oh, Incident Sorcery only. Okay, that's fine then. Freyalise. Make an elf destroy an artifact. All right. That's really annoying. It's not Captain Cissé where they can go start searching up threat after threat, but they can, you know, Adam can start making 1/1s and start flooding the board, and that's pretty annoying. So I'm going to have to use Jace here. I think I'm just going to brainstorm with Jace now. Ooh, that's a nice one. Let's brainstorm. Dimir Charm Regrowth for Walking Ballista could be good. I'm not going to Wrath this turn. Three, four, five, six. I can just slam Gravy Train. Kind of hard to argue with that. Here you go. Deal with that. I still have Mental Misstep, though. The applications for that are starting to grow a little bit thin. See what Adam's got this turn. Card is extremely awkward. Eight mana. That is no joke. Ugh! Ugin. So Ugin should probably just kill Jace. Although, no, that does leave Ugin at, what, 9? And I could just kill Ugin then? Maybe minus 2, that kills this, 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 and this. No, that, actually, this isn't that great. X equals, okay, so kill Jace, all of these, and then just give up Ugin. Okay, that's very reasonable. And then make a 1-1. All right, so I think I just need to buy back Walking Ballista. Let's see, I can buy back Walking Ballista, or I can just get Tezzeret and then just start tutoring up pieces. The problem is that they have to sit on the battlefield for a turn, and Fraelise is really annoying for that. All right, so I think, let's see here. I also could just Abrupt Decay this and kill Ugin. That seems fine. I could Dimir Charm this, which I should probably just do. So kill that. Kill Ugin. Unfortunately, Ugin exiles, so I can't buy back Jace with my regrowth. I could just Abrupt Decay the Mind Stone. It doesn't feel like I'm getting a better target for it at this point, though. Maybe I'm wrong. Walking Ballista seems pretty good here. I think I'm just going to get it. I'm just going to pass the turn. I have a Damnation on top of my library, but I probably don't want it. So I think I'm just going to crack Flooded Strand to shuffle it away unless something really shows me, no, you need to Wrath here for sure. Nasty Terasty, huh? Yeah, maybe I do need that Wrath. I mean, Grave Titan works pretty well here because of Death Touch, but even then, it's still not great. Let's see what Adam decides to do, though. Adam's relatively new to Highlander as well, and is still going to be figuring out how some of these cards, like how best to use them. You know, Terracidon's an incredibly flexible card, even though it looks like just some big green bomb. You can choose up to 3 targets, and you can choose not to do it if you want as well. All right, looks like he's just going to blow up 2 of his permanents and just make a bunch of, just make 2 elephants here. Then maybe ultimate here. Yeah, just draw 3. That seems pretty reasonable. It means I get to kill Fraelise next turn, but up to 5 cards. So I have a big question here. Do I want to draw Damnation here? I think the answer is no. Get a Watery Grave. Vendilion Click. All right, so we might be clicking here. Put a counter on this. And I'm gonna be killing Fraelise. Send this in. And we'll see what happens here, because if this just trades for it, then that's fine. If he goes for the 2 tokens, then I'm going to have to just get the 2-for-1. which is really annoying because he gets one turn where with all those cards, but he took out two of his mana sources, so it's not like the end of the world. Okay, so this actually worked out okay. I get to attack with everything next turn, assuming nothing sane comes down, and kind of force the trade with Grave Titan, and then these will all get in. Ugh. Pilgrim to, it's basically free here. Thragdad? It's not too bad, actually. Assume no attacks. And we hit a Misty Rainforest. So I think I'm just going to send in with all of these. And then basically, I assume this is going to get traded off here. And then that's going to block there. And then I can use Walking Ballista to finish off Thrag Tusk. And then I just have this army. Maybe it's actually better just to leave it. And what's the difference? I don't know that there's a huge difference between cashing in. I mean, they're just going to get a 3-3, which on this board is effectively the same card. Yeah, I'm just going to leave it. That way I can throw another counter at them. Oops. All right, so let's click on Yield Draw Step and see what's up. Now, I could click myself to get rid of this relatively useless mental misstep. I mean, I could have countered the Pilgrim, but there's, you know, there's other cards that they could have that I actually want to counter that kill Vendilion Click. Like, you know, they've got white, so it could be Plow or Path. I know that Adam was toying around with different removal spells on an earlier build of this. All right, so Captain Cisse still there. There's Eternal Witness and then plenty of mana for Hornet Queen. I don't think we can beat a Hornet Queen, so I have to take that away. They can Eternal Witness, but yeah, there's actually nothing super great. I guess Ugin, yeah, but probably not enough mana. Anyway, I got to take Hornet Queen away. Because I'm actually pretty close to winning the game here. Three in the air puts them to seven, attack with all of these. Let's say three of them get in, six, seven, one. You know, I'm going to have a Ballista that's going to be, you know, 3-3 or 4-4 by that time. Captain Cisse looks too slow for this board state. Yeah. Witness, and then I guess, can you actually cast Ugin? Oh, absolutely, right? 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. No, actually not. Oh, this guy. Oh. Oh, I should have killed it. I guess there was no, I would have had to do it on my turn. No, I could have done it during my draw step. Oh, you drew channel. I think you could have just cast it though. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, I don't think you need channel here. You can't really use the mana. All right, well, there's not much I can do. But I punted. Like, on my draw step, I could have added a counter and killed the Pilgrim. And that takes away effectively two mana from Adam, and that would have left Ugin out of range, although it wouldn't have mattered in this case because of the channel. But still, that is a mistake on my part. But yeah, this format's pretty complicated. I also could have just countered this thing, but all right. So Ugin can just minus zero to kill all the zombies. Can go up to three to kill the Click. That will really bum me out that I didn't kill this Thrag Tusk, by the way. But If Ugin does three, I still get to keep the Ballista. And the Ballista is still in pretty doing okay here, but we're definitely behind now. Oh, you can't attack. Definitely no attack. This Ballista could be easily enough to kill Ugin or you. Oh no. So I can put two counters on this thing and kill Ugin, and then it's just the world versus Thragtusk plus whatever, plus Captain Cisse. We'll just go for lethal and force the block. But I'm just going to unload on Ugin. But this is a free roll attack, so may as well. All right, now it's time to get lucky. I screwed up that sequence. It ended up not mattering because of channel, but I still left myself there. And then I still have the judgment call on whether I should trade this in for that. I suppose not in the long term, but this is going to be Captain Cisse now. And I have like one turn. Coiling Oracle. All right. Oh, I hit a land. That is no bueno. So now we're really screwed because Attic can just tap Captain Cisse, search up something insane, and just kill us. Or, you know, cast it and then kill us. Oracle's going to soak up 5 damage here pretty easy. All right. It's not that one. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. Legendary Planeswalker Karn. Deece. Good news is I don't have anything that cares as far as, like, he's going to plus Karn and just get a mental misstep. Which isn't a big deal. Oh, God. That is easily one of our worst draws at this point. Can't even cast it. Just going to get sniped by Karn. Could just search up another thing too. Man, I did not realize that Captain Cisse can get planeswalkers now. Oh, that could be lethal. No, it's 11. Need a double white? Oh, nice. Otherwise, we would have been dead. I mean, we are now anyway, but. Oh, sweet. I get to kill myself. All right. Another thing about Canadian Highlander, there's no sideboarding. So you just, boom, you're back in again. So when you build your deck, you have to consider all the options. But I tell you what, not having to worry about making a sideboard for a format like this is a big game. It's so much It's just like a load off, you know, because it's so, it's like modern. Like there's no good sideboarding anyway. So you just have to build your deck, you know, in a way that is more, you know, more well-rounded or more all in. It kind of depends on what you're trying to do. Yeah, sure. I'll keep this. This is a really slow hand for Highlander, but I have a scry land here that I can use to try to set up my top of my library. And I've got two pretty powerful three drops. Sure. So if we're lucky, we'll get to spell snare something and then follow up with one of these. If we're not lucky, they'll play some sick three drop and we'll just lose. Oh God. We are so doing it. Yes, 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 yes. Wait, why no attack? Leovold. This guy's obviously really annoying. Now, I think that Adam's deck isn't super worried about this card because it's not like he's reaching out to try to kill a bunch of our stuff or, you know, take cards out of our hand or whatever. But the card draw thing could be a thing. And, you know, even these decks do still interact with you on some level. No. Hopefully it's targetable. Probably just going to get like Hornet Queen. Yeah. All right. Well, this ends up being not the worst because I have Maelstrom Pulse, but otherwise we would just be dead here. Ooh, that's a good rip. Black, black, green. Pulse the insects. And then just ship. I don't want to trade off Leovold for the stupid Hornet Queen. And then I'm just going to play Tezzeret and start minusing to try to set up our combo. Okay. I take it. This is some amount of points and quite good. Zenith for two, huh? What is this? Scavenging news or Raffellos? Of course. We draw Venser. All right. Well, let's just go for it. So we're not in a great position here because Tezzeret's going to take two from Hornet Queen and Adam's going to have a ton of mana. But if we do get to untap, we may get to protect Tezzeret with Venser, Shaper, Savant, and then set up our combo. So it's not over yet. But we're in bad shape. I mean, again, anytime your opponent gets to untap with Raphelos, things are not good for you. This is where a card like Terastodon would be bad. You know, it can just blow up multiple permanents. And just, we don't really have an answer for it. We would get to draw some cards. And that is, you know, that is sort of the upside to Leovold here, right? Is that, like, my opponent kind of has to deal with Tezzeret. And they can start attacking it with Hornet Queen, but that's not, like, super great. So that goes down to one. Then I cast probably just Trigon Predator to block. Oh, attacked me? Well, that doesn't make any sense. That's just game then. Unless they have some other thing I'm not thinking about. So one thing that these decks can have, and I know that an earlier version of Adam's deck had it, are Legendary Eldrazi. And if they have a Legendary Eldrazi and you go to grindstone them out, they can, they will get shuffled back in. And so you can still lose. So if that's the case, then maybe I'll go for Nile Spellbomb and just cast Trigon Predator here. I also could play Engineered Explosives for two, blow it up, and kill Raphelos, but that doesn't seem great. Yeah, I'm gonna go for Nile Spellbomb. And assume that Adam still has some Legendary Eldrazi in the deck. And then the question is, do I want to leave up Venser? Because now this can just come in and kill this. Or do I want to play Trigon Predator and kind of have my shields down? If I play Predator, it can block this. That's kind of what I need to do. Adam could still just attack with everything. Yeah, I think I just need to leave Venser available, because if Adam does decide to just send in all three of them at Tezzeret, then I can play Venser, bounce the Hornet Queen, and block. Yeah, so that's better. Ooh, this is good and close. This is funny. So something's getting uncounterable here. Yet I have Venser, which doesn't care about that. Tooth and Nail with Entwine. So, yeah, I guess I just bounce that. But then this guy dies. So they're going to go get, like, Terastodon for sure, and blow up this, and maybe even that. I could just take my medicine. It seems really bad, though. If I bounce this back to hand, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I can actually keep them off of it for quite a while by using Engineered Explosives to kill Raphelos. Ugh, this is not what I want to be doing. This is not what I want to be doing. Now, if I get really lucky, I can rip one of my tutors or whatever and just put the combo together anyway. But now Tezzeret's dying. Scavenging news is not great. Sure. It's a lot of damage. So we know about Mana Leak and Spell Pierce in hand, which are right now not doing anything, but could be annoying. But if I get to play Scavenging News, I can eat up a bunch of these creatures and gain a bunch of life and just have a big old creature. Also, it might be worth it for me to just crack the Nile Spell Bomb. It's the only way I can beat a Legendary Eldrazi, but if I'm going to draw the other half of my combo, but I don't actually have that many of that, so I'm going to just go ahead and do this. Because I get a card. Oh. Obviously, I draw my tutor with it. Oh, that is so funny. All right, so let's play Scavenging Ooze. See if he wants to play Mana Leak on it just to make me pay. No. All right. In that case, I will jam. He's going to go for Mystical Tutor, so I'm going to respond with Tainted Pact. No blue mana available. So, do I want to put Duress in my hand? No, so I think I'm just going to go for... Force of Will. All right. Well, it took away most of our library to do it. But this way, we can maintain the slim lead that we have here. Now they have enough to just play Tooth and Nail without Entwine, but if they've got something huge in their hand that they just want to do, they could just put it into play. I don't actually know what he can get. I mean, he already has the Tooth and Nail. Maybe just a, I don't know, another counter of some sort? I don't actually know. Ooh, Treasure Cruise with 8 cards left in the library. Do we go for it? I think we do. Very nice. A counterspell. Yep, you take two. Go ahead. I'm going to leave up the mana. All right, Mirari's Wake. So the question here is, do I want to shuffle this away? Or mill it away, I should say. Two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. With any land, which they're very likely to hit, or, you know, not unlikely to hit, they could just entwine away. Although they won't actually have the mana. Oh, they can make it uncounterable. Yeah, I suppose I need to do something about that then, don't I? I don't think I can win this though. I mean, not literally can't win this, but like, I don't think there's like a reasonable, like if I get super lucky off the top of my library, I could win this, but so this is gonna be an entwined up whatever. Down to three here. You got it. So what do we see here? A couple of Eldrazi of some sort? There's one. But remember, no trigger from Ulamog. Tooth and Nail's just going to put them into play. And then, you know, if he goes for something like a Terracidon and wants to blow up my stuff, I do get cards, though. With only five left, I don't even know if that's that great for me. But I figure I'd take them. I figured I'd take him. Okay, just going to go for the hoof. That's probably lethal then, right? It's going to be 9. Oh, yeah, it's easily lethal. Oh, he didn't even actually go for the... He put this in his hand. But... These still have summoning sickness, but they add to the count. Oh, he didn't even put it in his hand. I see. This is just top of his library. I obviously got confused there. All right. GG's. So Adam beat us in that one. We're going to be playing 3 matches. So that was the first one. I want to remind you that you can order Rivals of Ixalan right now on ChannelFireball.com. All singles are available as well as sealed products. So head on over if you need any Rivals stuff. Maybe if you're a Canadian Highlander deck, we'll see you in round number 2. All right, welcome back to round number 2. So we've got my bug value Canadian Highlander deck against Adam's ramp deck. This deck was performing quite well, I thought. Let's see if we can't get him here, though. So it looks like a decent hand. As we saw, Leovold is only okay against Adam's deck. Adam's going to be on the play, so we're going to want to thought seize him. Kind of right away here. See what he's working with. It's going to tutor up something. Sylvan, okay. That goes on top of his library. And we can take Emrakul, Awakening Zone, or Hangarback Walker. Hangarback, I think we can just bounce with Jace, so we're not that worried about it. Obviously, Emrakul, we're fine with leaving in hand, so I'm just going to take away Awakening Zone. This is in his hand now. This is no longer in his hand. So next turn, nothing. Then I think I'm just going to go for explosives on two and try to limit how much value he can get from Sylvan Library. That's the kind of card that can completely get out of hand. So what I'm going to want to do is next turn, blow up explosives and play Divining Top. Maybe a spot where Adam wants to just cash in eight life to draw two cards, by the way, especially if he knows the library is going to go away. That wouldn't have been the worst time to just do that. I mean, my deck isn't great at putting on pressure, but it can kind of turn the corner and get you a bit. So, you know, you don't want to go too crazy. All right, so now he has to decide if he wants to put counters on this or just run out the hangar back. Let's see what he decides. He's going to go for the hangar back. Reasonable. So let's pull up the library. Play the top. And pass. And we'll see what we draw. If we draw a land, I'm probably just going to slam Oracle because the upside on Oracle is so absurdly high. Mm-hmm. And then maybe just put a counter on this and attack. Only card in hand is Emrakul, the Aeon's Torn. Adam's got a bit of a ways to go before that's going to happen. All right. All right, we drew a land. So we're going to just slam Oracle here. One time. Sure. That's all fine. If we hit a land, we get to use Zensei's Divining Top. Ooh, another Jace. That's pretty good. This Jace is better with Oracle Moldiah because you can rearrange your library so that you get to just clean off all the lands. It's really a deadly combo. But in this specific instance, it's not amazing. We've already got Divining Top anyway to do a similar effect. So we may be able to get away with just playing a Jace here. Ballista. All right, so probably best to just top and hopefully see a land out of the top three. All right, we did, except for it's a tap land. So that goes on top. That goes on top, and then we'll put that on top and play it. I guess I just slam Scavenging Ooze here. No, I guess I'll play the bad boy himself. Of course, if I tap the right mana, that would probably be a little better. There we go. And we'll start digging around with the top and Jaces and such next turn, but I like the idea of getting this guy down as a potential blocker. Think a pretty reasonable line, assuming no disasters happen here, is to play Jace, is to top and play Jace next turn and just bounce the Walker. Another reasonable line would be to play Ballista and kill Jiraga Tree Speaker as soon as possible, but we need more mana for that. All right. That's pretty good. Can't bounce that one. All right, so we know Thrag Tusk is on the top. Let's dig. Him to Turok. All that does is get rid of Emrakul. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, he'd need to get super lucky to be able to cast that. So we'll do that. And then I think what I'm going to do is just play this Jace. So let's do this again and see if we hit a land. Cryptic Command. Not bad. But I'm just going to play this Jace and just plus him. That pretty much protects from everything here. And we just have to hope that Adam doesn't get lucky and rip Cradle or another 7 drop or something like that. Because if I can get this Jace out and have it stick, then I can get this Jace out and protect it. And that's kind of a sick combo. Not going to be able to utilize Cryptic to like steal a win here, but still not bad. Yep. So Jace takes 1, goes back down to 4. Do I get to untap, though? Land? Yes, I do. All right. So let's top yet again. There's another land. Yeah, let's just play Jace. And let's try to lock out Adam from finding any really great threats. So we don't care if he draws that. Should I play the Ballista or not is the question. I think the answer is no. And I'm not really a huge fan of playing the Scavenging Ooze, so I think I'm just going to do another top. I don't have another land drop to give here, so I can't use it, but... So you can attack with this, and I suppose Hangerback could get in as well. Becomes a 3-4. Yeah, he decided not to attack with it. All right, so this one's hitting up Chase the Mind Sculptor. I think I'm going to go for a big Walking Ballista next turn. And this is going to be Basalt Monolith. I think this is 11 mana. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Yeah. So let's see if we can find something a little better. There's a Treasure Cruise. That's pretty good. Well, we really just want to get these lands cleared out of here. So let's see if there's anything scary coming up that we need. A land, no. So that's land number 12. We don't care about that. Now, that means I can just do this and just cast Treasure Cruise here. So now I can, let's see, am I ever, do I need to leave up Cryptic Command at all? Probably not. I could just him to Turok and just take away all threats, but that shuffles the library, so I'd want to do that after. I don't care about the land, so I'm just going to let that happen. Question is, do I need to leave up Cryptic here? This thing's going to be a 5-5. Can actually start attacking pretty well. I could return it to its owner's hand and draw a card, for example. This thing can counter a lot of the stuff my opponent does, but not, you know, non-creature spells. Yeah, I don't think it's that big of a deal. All right, so this is going to go on top, then this, then this. Play that. Do this again. Just play Scavenging Ooze. Probably just going to chump block with the Scavenging Ooze. Should be attacking with the hanger back, I think. I don't really want to lose any, like, either of these two. And if you get, make me just chump block with my Scavenging Ooze, that's pretty good. I don't think getting this thing up to, you know, bigger and bigger is really helping. It looks like he's still just going to sit back on it, though. All right. Jace's in arms look like they're doing good work here. Yeah, I'm not going to him still. Can have that one. Do a little of that. See if we can't hit here. Ponder, that's perfect. Let's just cast this big dumb thing. So 3, 5, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and then another thing on top is 13. So I think I'm just going to use this Walking Ballista to just start clearing away the cobwebs here. And then I'll probably, once I get those things dead, I'll probably just bounce hanger back with Cryptic, keep plussing Jace. We should be able to win this game from here. pretty handily. This is just a deadly combo against a specific board that we happen to be against. I'm just going to start by killing this, and then I'll work my way down the line. Make sure this is right, and then I can just F6. Yeah, all right. The old double check top. I don't care about that elf because I can just kill it. I'm not going to use a misstep on it. All right, so let's ponder. And we'll probably just end up shuffling here because I don't really want this stuff anyway. Miscalculation, land, another land. All right, now we're cruising. Do a little of this. That is an interesting one, though, because he can actually do something with that. I'm just going to start doing this nonsense. And I can just pass here. Yep, 3, 5, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. I gave him a land. That is 14. But it is not 15. Hello, cat. You want to play Highlander? Usually you like draft better, but fair enough. Now, the interesting thing about the foothills is that it means that when I plus Jace, Adam will have the opportunity to shuffle away whatever card I put back, which is kind of cool. Do that. Do a little of this. Adam will likely shuffle that away. I could just ultimate this and go get something else. Oh, actually, this is super sweet. So let's him Adam and then ultimate Jason go get his own Emrakul. Who's in for that? Oh, that's awesome. So this is our deck. Whatever, I don't even care what we get. Sure, just get some value, I guess. Not Ulamog. Emrakul. Where is it? Exile? Click any spell to cast it. Where are they? That's my library. Where are the spells? What's going on here? There we go. I just had to hit OK. Well, this is just sweet. I get to take an extra turn. Get my extra turn. All right. So that was kind of sweet. I didn't even think about ultimating that, Jace. All right. So to sideboarding, but as you know, we don't sideboard, so right back into it. Ooh. All right, this looks okay. We've got Fatal Push plus Engineered Explosives, plus we do have Force of Will for anything particularly egregious in the early stages. Manowar would have been sweet last game. Now, this is one of the things about Highlander is that, you know, it's a competitive format, so you're meant to play the best possible stuff. But I find that with 100-card singleton decks, you get a few slots that are a little bit more flexible than that. And I like to use those for cards that I think are, you know, maybe a little underrepresented. You know, like I think Manowar is really good in a lot of situations, and some of them aren't obvious. It's also my favorite card, so I play it. Could I find something better in that slot? Probably, but I think it actually does some unique, cool stuff that you don't see that often, and so I play it. You know, and it's and this is what happens when you play 100 card singleton, is that you can find slots for things you wouldn't normally. All right, I'm just gonna leave Niall Spellbomb in hand here, and leave up Fatal Push for something here. No? All right. Let's pass. I can Spell Pierce something or Fatal Push anything, basically. Don't think Spell Pierce is particularly good against Adam. His deck looks pretty creature heavy and has tons of mana. So my inclination is that if I have the opportunity to Spell Pierce anything, I should just do it. Yeah, that'll resolve. And then I guess I just go for the Fatal Push here. I think I could make a pretty good argument for doing it on my turn when I can leave Spell Pierce up, so I'm going to do that. Now, if Adam has his own Spell Pierce or something similar, I can kind of get him. I guess he could have 4-mana Planeswalker that I'd want to Spell Pierce, that I'd feel super bad if I didn't leave it up, I guess. Enclave Cryptologist, you say. All right, I'll play that. This is getting bad, though. Missing these land drops is really going to catch up with us. Cryptologist is pretty good in our deck. It's very slow. It's a very slow card. But what it does well is it puts cards in the graveyard for Delve, which I have a few Delve cards. I've got Tastigar. I used to run Dig Through Time, but it got pointed, so I don't run it anymore. You saw Treasure Cruise as well. So that's good. It's kind of a double punch there as far as getting through the deck and finding the answers or the threats that we need. And then against Control, if they don't kill it, like it's the type of card you can play on turn one and just dump mana into. And it starts drawing cards when it gets to the third level, and they just have to spend a removal spell. Like, if they don't, they lose to it. And that's pretty good. It can become its own game plan where you're, like, protecting it and stuff. I kind of like that. All right, Temple of Mystery is pretty good. Tassigur, we do not want here. So should I level up? I think so. I can't play a land this turn, so I'm just going to wait to actually loot. Or I can't play another land this turn, I should say. But here we go. Shields down. So this is where things could get really ugly for us. I have the Force of Will. So if it's something really bad, I can deal with it. But, you know, you don't really want to use that unless you have to. Vendilion Click. That's pretty good. All right. I'm just going to get rid of Spell Pierce here. Woodland Cemetery will come in untapped. So let's go for Jace. Let's just go for the big boy here. See what kind of counter magic maybe we're dealing with on the other side. Remand. Yeah, I think that's probably worth it. Because I get cards right now, and I get kind of an unchecked Jace here, which can really do a lot of work. Like, it's a little scary to leave the shields down and use my counter spell to protect my creature, but that's a pretty big game. All right, I'm just going to choose pile one. I'm going to assume that Adam doesn't have much to do as far as cheap stuff goes, because he kind of would have. I mean, he's had four mana for three or four turns in a row now that he could have used it on anything that costs one, two, or three. So normally I would just take the spell, but I'm just going to go for the lands. I mean, he need to hit lands anyway. Oh, what'd you find? What is it? Oblivion Ring. Okay, that's pretty good. So O-Ring the Jace, I assume? Yeah, okay. I got to live with that. Oblivion Ring's a good kind of catch-all, you know. So let's loot. Also, by the way, taking the hand with two things lets me work through this. So I can engineer an explosive to blow up O-Ring at some point. That's probably worth it. Ooh, I like Toxic Deluge a lot. But you know what else I like? I like drawing cards. Sure, I'll throw the grindstone out, I guess. All right, one more sort of hold our breath moment. But if we get to untap here, boy, we could really do some work. Untap with Mana Leak, Vendilion Click, a lot of disruption. All right, found that four mana Planeswalker finally. And we're going to have to start probably trying to apply pressure to it with Vendilion Click. Ooh, or with Moldrifter. Straw card. The Mirror Charm. Okay, so I think we're going to have to spend a turn to Vendilion Click here. And then I think, let's see. Oh man, I really wanted to hit a land here. Because I actually want to Eternal Witness back Force of Will to protect from anything. This can kind of protect us. It can counter sorcery spells, but it's pretty mediocre overall. I guess we have to just sort of lean on Vendilion Click to take away something, and we can have Mana Leak up in case it's something really scary. The question is, do I actually wait until their turn? I can just cast Vendilion Click main phase, and yes, I don't get the draw step, so that they have one opening, but I don't have to discard. And these are all kind of good cards. I could discard the Dimir Charm, though. Yeah, I think I'm going to be a little greedy here and just go ahead and main phase the Vendilion Click so I don't have to discard. My opponent will have a one draw step opening, you know, opening where they can draw something that I can't deal with, but I think I got to live with it. All right, 1, 2, 3, 4. I don't think I can. I think I can deal with all of this stuff. The mana leak counters everything here except for Mind Stone. So I'm just going to leave it. And try to kind of ride the Vendilion Click to victory here. Because the worst that Garrett can do here is get up to 3 loyalty, in which case Vendilion Click can do work. And Adam may just go for Elishnorn, thinking, well, that wipes my board. Like, it's such high upside. I mean, he's going to know, right, that, like, I wouldn't leave Elishnorn if it was like, you draw a land, you cast Elishnorn, you clear out my entire board, and, you know, things get really bad for me. But at the same time, he may feel like he just needs to press that advantage right now. Basically, my main goal here is just to stay one step ahead of Adam. He's got a really good hand, and he has a pretty powerful board. But if I can counter whatever he does here and then attack Vendilion Click into Garrick, kill Garrick, I can probably deal with whatever beasts are left over if there's one there. So I have to just counter this. Oh, I should have just used this. Yeah, that was a punt. That was a good use for Dimir Charm. I kind of had it earmarked for Force of Will, which is what it'll end up doing. But I could have used it there and just kept the mana leak. So that was a little loose. Got a little excited there, but that's okay. All right, let's draw a card. That's pretty good here too. Kill Garrick. Okay, so what I need to do now is I need to, first things first, I need to get back Force of Will. Okay, so that kind of has to happen, and then cast the spell bomb and then pass. And then I'm going to try to set up a two-turner here where I cast Tezzeret, search up my guy, use Grindstone, and then use Nile spell bomb and mill my opponent out. So this is going to be Elishnorn. Oh, Genesis Wave for 4. All right, well, that worked out really well for me because I get to Dimir Charm that instead. Black and then drop is fine, I guess. Yeah, and then I just need to basically protect all of this nonsense with Force of Will. Obviously, Enclave Cryptologist has been kind of an all-star here. All right, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, out of 4, I mean. Let's see, keep up those two is fine. And what I think I want to do here is, let's see, I can just counter about anything. Yeah, I guess I just search him up. I was going to try to just leave Tezzeret up, but then like it gets kind of awkward. There's Painter's Servant. Everything is blue. Now I can exile whatever I want. Go. So the way this works, by the way, for people that haven't seen this before, is Painter's Servant says, as it enters the battlefield, choose a color. I can make every spell that isn't on the battlefield and all permanents. Everything is blue. I can choose whatever color I want. I chose blue because I have Forcible in my hand. And then Grindstone says, you mill somebody for two, but if the cards share a color, you do it again and again and again and again and again. So as you can see, I'm in a situation where I've made my opponent's entire library blue. So if I activate Grindstone, it will mill out their whole library. But there's a catch. They have Eldrazi in their deck. And if they've got Eldrazi going in their deck, what that means is that those get shuffled back in and they shuffle in the whole library. But if I exile their library with that ability on the stack, then that doesn't happen anymore. I guess I just duress here. I have the win, but I don't really see a big downside to just throwing a duress at them. All right, Mirari's Wake, Anaconda Send, which I will take away. Play a Delta. All right, one, two. I just need black mana. Oh, I don't even need black mana, actually. So mill you, and now you're going to see their whole entire library go away. And then there's these two triggered abilities. So now I'm going to activate. They have to put those on the stack. And then I'm going to put Nile Spellbomb ability on the stack. And so the way this works is both the Emrakul and the Ulamog are in the graveyard. I don't actually see them, but they're somewhere in here. And then so they're actually going to get exiled away with the Nile Spellbomb. Sure, we'll get value. And then these triggers try to shuffle everything together, and it doesn't work. And then I just pass the turn. I don't even need to do anything. And then the game ends. All right, so we won that one. That means we get one more match for a decider. All right, third and final match. We won the die roll. Yeah, this is an okay keep. Duress actually isn't that good against Adam. It hits a couple of his key spells that we've seen, like Tooth and Nail and stuff. But, you know, I wouldn't call it amazing. But we do have Engineered Explosives, which I think is quite good against him. It solves, if he's got a bunch of elves, we can clear those out, that kind of thing. I think I just wait a turn here. Like, what is he going to play on turn one that I'm super concerned about with Duress? I don't think there's a lot. He's most likely just going to play an elf of some sort like that. All right, so I think what I want to do is just play Engineered Explosives here. Oops. And I guess I will just duress him now. I was going to wait, but I can always snap it back. I might as well just get some value, and then I for sure can get rid of this thing. All right, so he's got Fintorn Elves, Wall of Roots, and three lands. And I get to take away Duress. That's pretty good. Or take away Garrick. That's pretty good, actually. And he actually can't play the Finhorn Elves here. So that's sweet, too. Now, I don't really have anything going on, so that's the bad news. But if I can draw myself a card draw spell or something like that, we could be off to the races. A Planeswalker would be fantastic. I have a lot of live draws here. So I think Adam should probably just put a counter on this thing and pass. I guess what he should do is just play the Wall of Roots. Put a counter on it and play the Wall of Roots. Because that way, it kind of forces the issue. Like, I can't let him untap with all that mana. I have to use Engineered Explosives. What? This is a little risky to let him untap with this mana, but like I can prevent him from playing. Like the last we saw, he had nothing to spend it on, and I can prevent him from playing. There you go. He should have done that last turn. He should attack. There you go. I like that because I have to kind of take it because I'm going to pop this on end step now and hopefully draw a planeswalker. But now, it prevents him from playing the Finhorn Elves. Spell Snare. Well, where have you been all my life, Spell Snare? So, running out the Painter Servant does not seem amazing. Flashing back Duress does not seem amazing either. Maybe I'll just run out the Painter Servant to try to get him to like panic or something. I don't actually care about it. Like with this type of draw, it's not a realistic win condition at this point. Like it's such not a win condition that like I actually want him to counter it. Like I want him to use any resources he can on it. Now, if I get lucky, it becomes a win condition, but I have to draw a card like Tezzeret the Seeker or something along those lines. There's the Finhorn Elves. Haha, I have a blocker, taste it. Ooh, we did it. Wow, that was lucky. Jace? Yes. Draw a bunch of cards. Regrowth, huh? Guess I don't want these lands. Because remember, I can shuffle any of this stuff away. Yeah, I'll just shuffle away the lands, I suppose. They don't seem great here. And I may need to cast Spell Snare, though. It's unlikely. What would I counter? I could counter like a... there's a few things I could counter for sure. All right, I'm going to go ahead and just shuffle away those lands right now. I think that we won't have any problem hitting our land drops, and drawing two basics off the top feels pretty bad. Looks like he's going to respond by cracking his Marshlots. He may actually have something to do. He might like have a counter or a removal spell or something. What do I have? Blue, black. I've got all my colors. I can get like Breeding Pool tapped, I guess. Okay, draw a card. Miscalc, not bad, but not great. Let's see what we've got. Woo! There's some action. I don't think I actually want Regrowth at the moment. And Snapcaster is actually not looking super hot. I might actually just play Moldrifter. Just slam him. Can hit a land drop off of the Moldrift or clear up the lands off the top so I can hit lands next turn and kind of keep the value train rolling here. Uh-oh. Mana's being tapped. Just leave my little JC alone. What did he ever do to you? Whoa, Mirari's Wake. Uh-oh. Ruh-roh. Another Jace, huh? Well, I'm just going to keep on being greedy here and going for my own cards because I want to hit some lands here, maybe a shuffle effect to get some of this junk, this thing out of here, that kind of stuff. All right, here's some business. I don't want that right now. Treasure Cruise looks pretty good. I'm going to play Reflecting Pool. I want to leave up some of this stuff. Probably not going to be regrowthing at the moment. I think I just want to leave up Venser, though. I wonder how good he plays against Packrat. Let's find out. I have infinite cards. I can turn them into stuff. Oh, no. Counterspell, and I just put back that thing. Let's see here. I can make him pay two life, or I can just Venser that thing. Or I can just say sure. I think I'm going to Venser it. Venser it's actually pretty good because I can play around it now. It makes it a lot worse. Battle. And just try to spew out a bunch of rats going forward. Because now that I've resolved it, it's going to be tough for Adam to deal with it. And I can kind of go crazy with the rats. Although Adam does have infinite mana. Did he have any like Eldrazi when I saw his hand? No, it was lands and the elf. But he might have, I mean, he could have any huge spell here and just destroy me. Ooh, that's a good one. That one is nice. He's got 11 mana left over. We are throwing haymakers this time. Rafellos? Oh my god. Oh my god. Glenalendra Archmage. That puts a damper on our plans. I can just bounce her, but still, that's pretty good. I'm going to brainstorm. Manowar? My boy. I don't need regrowth right now, and I don't think I'm treasure cruising this turn. But I can play Manowar to bounce Glenalendra Archmage, which is kind of sweet. So let's do that. Interesting. Did not expect him to do that. All right, I'm going to Spell Snare. And then that kind of forces the issue with Glenalendra. And shrinks her down where she can't attack Jace anymore. It's actually awkward that I tap this way, though, because I can't counterspell back now. But all right. Fair enough. So this actually works out okay, though. And then I play Baby Jace. So now my Moldrifter keeps Glenelander Archmage at bay, and it means that I get to keep Jacing every turn. I'm probably going to start plussing Jace just to keep Adam off of anything insane. I want to get Jace flipped at some point here. This one, though, it doesn't do a ton. I'm just going to have to cycle this as it doesn't do anything anymore. And maybe I'll just start going to town with Deathrite Shaman. Basically, I want to try to set up a scenario where I can keep on using Jace, either plussing or brainstorming to generate value, and then keep Adam off of something key. So probably need to plus Jace to do that, just because I won't have a great option. Well, there's a Wooded Foothill, so that's a little bit annoying. Yeah, looks like we got a little unlucky here. He got something big. Nah, he top decked Emrakul. All right. Well, that's game. And what he actually should have done there is attacked with Glenelander Archmage, because Emrakul is actually not lethal. So I can just like sack my board and hope to rip and like chump block with Moldrifter and hope to rip Toxic Deluge. Now this actually works out pretty good though, because I either have to sack lands or creatures. I can return Emrakul to hand. Unless it's attacking Jace. Okay, so I need to sack six things. Yeah, I'm just super dead here. Soak up so that I don't die. Yeah, we just needed that extra turn, basically. Can't even imagine what we can draw at this point. And the answer is nothing. All right. Once more into the fray. But Adam does have a decent number of huge finishers, I'm sure. That one, of course, being the most brutal. This looks good. Yeah, this is actually pretty sweet. Enclave Cryptologist. It has Dryad Arbor, which I sometimes have in the deck and sometimes don't. I think it's an awful magic card, but it does do something kind of important. If I run Green Sun Zenith, and so I have a package of cards that I can get with Green Sun Zenith, and Dryad Arbor is the one you can get on zero. So it's actually pretty good for that. Gonna pass here. probably just try to loot away the Dryad Arbor into another land. It's just such a slow, crappy land. You know, just finding another blue source would let me leave up Spell Pierce for something, and, you know, I can still put an end still cast Baleful Strix, or I could just leave Mana Leak available. I could just do that either way, but... So, let's see how that goes. This is a big turn. Something like Rephelos would be really annoying here. Sylvan Library would be bad. Wall of Roots isn't that big of a deal. That I can deal with. So let's see what we draw here. If it's a land, I'm just going to pitch Dryad Arbor. Yeah, that's fine. And another land. I think I just want to leave Mana Leak up here, though. It's tempting to put a counter on it and leave up Spell Pierce, but if my opponent plays, you know, an important creature at this juncture and I don't have the answer for it, I could just fall too far behind where even Enclave Cryptologist can't dig me back. And if I just wait a turn, I can maybe counter something here and then just play Baleful Strix and leave up Mana Leak and Spell Pierce, or I can put another counter on it and leave those up. Or I can just go level next turn and just draw a card right away and just say, okay, I'm just going to cross my fingers and, you know, hope. There's a lot of cards I would counter here, though. Planeswalkers, all that kind of stuff. Awakening Zone. Perfect. That is kind of the actual just ideal what we wanted Adam to play here. Okay, draw a card. Do not want Grave Titan. It's a really good card, but it's not what we want right now. River of Tears, and then, yeah, I think I'm just going to go for a level counter here and just kind of like chain these together with two drops, basically. We can cast Scavenging News, though it doesn't look super great here. In fact, if we ended up discarding it, I wouldn't be that surprised. But I'm looking to Mana Leak something here, not that. Okay, let's see what we hit. Lands are actually pretty good. All right, we don't need too many of them. Now, should I leave up Cryptic? No, I think I should level. Because drawing extra cards from this point out is so powerful. Ooh, very nice. I don't think we're going to hit anything, though. I think we would have seen it, so we'll probably whiff, but at least we'll know what we're up against. Also, we could hit a counterspell. I haven't actually played anything. Wow, he didn't even run it out there. It's interesting. Decided there wasn't anything worth getting anyway. 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, he's actually got 6. All right, so I need to leave up mana for the for Mana Leak here. And then I get to sit back behind Mana Leak and Cryptic Command. And if he just goes for Karn next turn, I Mana Leak it, untap, draw an extra card, pass with Cryptic Command. After playing a Baleful Strix, like, this could get really good for us. It's just this next, like, one or two turns. Need to be able to Mana Leak whatever this is, which is probably Karn Liberated. Looks like he's going to play around it a little here. I want to get another blue source here. And then I can just leave Foothills because it can just tap for black anyway. Draw more cards. I'm just going to pass. I'm not going to bother with the Baleful Strix. Adam could be trying to set up for casting Karn with some type of counterspell backup, so I want to have two counters and just play extra safe. I'm drawing two cards a turn. I don't need to get crazy here. So, like, he might just leave this blue mana untapped. No, it looks like he's decided to go for Karn now. He could have last turn. Oh, no. He's got something else. Oh, the big and the nasty. I guess I have to counter that. And now the missing piece of the puzzle for me is like a planeswalker or a card draw spell to just... to just put us over the top is what I was going to say. That works. That's a fine one. Patrick. I've already played a land this turn. Suppose I should keep my options as open as possible, though. Well, I guess I'll regrowth that in a little bit, but for now I'm just going to sit, and we are in super good shape. I can crypto command the guy. The Karn, and then I can regrowth either the Ancestral, the Cryptic, whichever one we want. It sounds weird, but I think we might actually just get the Cryptic back because it's like a 2-for-1 rather than a 3-for-1, but it does exactly what we need it to do. Riptide Lab doesn't do much here. Let's draw a card, see what we hit. To see gray, that's a good one here. Not actually gonna activate this. This is just a threat of activation bluff. It actually worked. I am gonna get cryptic rather than recall. Or rather than Ancestral, I should say. I know that's a little bit weird, but we just need to make sure that we maintain this position. Just for like another turn or two, and then we'll be golden. And like I said, Cryptic is 2/3 of an Ancestral. I mean, it counters one of their spells and it draws you a card, so... That is what you want to do. Where we could just draw three whatevers here and be in pretty bad shape. All right, let's make a pack rat token. Sure. Abrupt Decay. Counterspell, very nice. I'm playing kind of fast here, but I want to make sure that it's fun for you to watch, too. And these games can get really intense. The corollary that most people like to use, and I think is a very fair one, is that it plays somewhat like Cube. If you like a Vintage Cube or something like that, it has some similarities to that. It looks like Adam's flooding out a bit for us here. By the way, All-Star... Wake. I'm not even sure I care about that. Yeah, I'm going to let that resolve. I can just kill it with this anyway. Of course, it comes down to one last final game. We're going to see if Adam's deck is definitely faster. Our deck is not fast. It's very mid-rangey, trying to kind of make sure it has answers for a lot of stuff in the format. His deck is also towards the mid-range, it seems, but also has some much quicker starts than ours does. This is mediocre, but I'll keep it. It's got a little bit going on. Just going to start off with the Deathrite Shaman. Yep. Ooh. We both have probably the best one-drop creatures in our decks. And I'm going to turn to him. And then maybe turn three him again. It depends on the land thing. Ooh, that's bad. Now I have a counter spell. Interesting. So I'm pretty limited on what I can actually do here because I can only use this once. So for example, I could play Wooded Foothills and leave up Counterspell. Or I could play Wooded Foothills and him. Or I can try to set up for Venser the next turn. And then try to find a blue mana source or a land in the graveyard to counter Sylvan Library on the way back down, though the damage may be done at that point. I cannot Thought Scour this turn unless I'm willing to give up one of my blue hits here. I could just play Temple of Mystery and pass and just do nothing this turn. Hope that Adam maybe puts a land into the graveyard that I can Thought Scour with. That's like my peak. If I just go for the him right now, it's not too bad for me. I could Thought Scour plus him. That's probably my best line. So let's get him out of hand here, and then we're going to Thought Scour ourselves. Ooh, wow, that's pretty good. And then we're going to hope that we hit more lands, because that turns on Deathrite Shaman again. We were hoping to him away a land here, but that didn't end up happening. This could be a very, poor Adam, this could be a very, very Deathrite Shaman-centric game, though, because right now Deathrite is turning on my whole hand, and also is a very viable win condition. I mean, I've already, you know, I can start just activating it every turn and really applying pressure to Adam, who's having a tough opening start here. And if Adam gets greedy and starts, you know, just hitting that, sure, yeah, like that button right there, that can start to add up really quick with Deathrite. All right, so let's see if we get lucky and hit a land here. We did. Ooh, and we hit another land too. That's pretty nice. This is interesting. So Wasteland is also yet another land that I can use. I think I would just want to Wasteland the Flooded Grove and leave up Counterspell. My other line, though, is kind of good, which is play Wasteland and then on upkeep, cast Venser, bounce Sylvan Library. All that really does, though, is make him just tap two mana and cast it again, but he doesn't get the addition of it. The problem is I can't counter it on the way back down if I do that. So my other line would be play Wasteland, go. You get your Sylvan Library activation. On end step, I cast Venser, I bounce it, and then I pass back, leaving up Counterspell, which is like a little tedious, but maybe the best line. Really hate giving him more activations, but yeah, I think I need to do it. The other thing this does let me do, though, is leave up Counterspell in case something catastrophic happens here. Resto. I don't think that's going to be great in his deck. What else does he have? Probably like Acidic Slime, something like that. Didn't seem super amazing, though. That is a good little clock, though. But Thragdad can help with that. Tussles nicely with Resto. We can just jam a bunch of times. Okay, hit me for four. Not bad, not bad. Okay, this actually works too. So now I cast Venser, I bounce Library, and then I Snapcaster back him and just get it out of his hand the old-fashioned way, I guess. Though I do need a second black mana source to do that, so I guess I can't. Yeah, this is actually, I need to find, wow, this, oh no, I can do it with this, right? Actually, no, I still need another, I need another color of mana. This is interesting. Huh? Tassiger, okay. So I can waste this and have three mana. Yeah, so I just have to counter it. Eh, that's a little bit annoying, but it's okay. I don't think I want that. Like, I'm under pretty serious pressure here. I need to find an answer for Restoration Angel. Like I said, the Thragtusk does some amount of work, but it's not going to do it all. I do want to chip in for as much damage as I can. Yeah, so I'll just have to counter the Sylvan Library on the way back down, and then just keep, I guess, trying to chip away. Maybe I can race with Thragtusk plus Deathrite, something like that. I don't know. I might just lose to Resto. Resto's hitting me hard for a turn. Okay, so we got the long-term problem solved with that, but the Restoration Angel is a short-term problem, and it's a major issue. Where were you last turn? That would have been perfect. Could just cast Thragtusk here. That's probably correct. Moo Cow, go. So we're up to 14. If I get to untap, I can Snapcaster counter or Snapcaster just him away whatever's in hand. And then just try to win a race with Deathrite Shaman and Moo Cow. That's probably reasonable. It's hard because this thing is hitting hard, but I can eventually force a chump here. That reduces the clock. And then are there creatures? There's one. There's two creatures in the graveyard, so I can start gaining life and reduce this to only two a turn. I should be able to win from there, assuming nothing terrible happens here, of course. I've been trying to chip in for as much damage as possible to punish. Like, even the one activation of Sylvan Library is four. I mean, that's 15 versus 11 here. It's a big difference. Two-turn clock, just straight up. Eternal Witness for what? This is going to tell us a lot about what we need to do. Like, if he gets Channel, I'm just snapping off the him to Turok because he's got a Eldrazi or something. Although, now that I look at it, actually, Channel doesn't really do a lot here. Maybe just get Primeval Titan. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Hit a land in Primeval. No, you're getting back Channel. All right. Well, I'm going to attack you with a bunch of stuff. What is Channel going to do? Could have just cast it, right? Did I miss something? I thought, anyway. All right, well, let's just jam here. Get in. So you're down to 9. What are you going to channel for? Because I could just say go and let them channel down a bunch and then counter whatever they channel. But it's like, could you possibly get to Emrakul from here? 2, 8, 9, 10, 11. No. You could cast with 11. You could cast Ulamog, though. That would probably end the game. Actually, I would counter Ulamog, but you get to kill something. But you'd be at 1, and then I could just kill you. Go. I don't understand what it could be. Also, Adam has not played much against Deathrite Shaman. This was before his time, so he may not know. So I'm going to let channel happen. And Adam can use up to 6 mana here. God, don't do it, Adam. 3, 2, tooth and nail. Bummer. Yeah, I think he just didn't know what this did, to be honest. All right. Yeah, so that's, of course, one of the other things with Canadian Highlander is that it's a huge pool of cards, so you have to kind of get used to all the different options, all the different onboard stuff. Anyway, that was an introduction, just a very brief. I mean, there's a ton of different decks and a lot going on in the format. That's a deck that I built myself, so that's not even like necessarily like a tier one, you know, World Crusher type deck. That's just like a deck I've worked on for a while, and Adam built his deck as well. But if you want to see more, there's the Canadian Highlander website that I mentioned before, and I think it's, I'll just look it up real quick. It's CanadianHighlander.wordpress.com. You can see it here. And this has information on it about the points list, about the kind of how does the format work and all that kind of stuff. And yeah, really cool format. Honestly, I think it's the best constructed format going. It's super, super fun. It's a Brewer's Paradise, and you get to play with all the old good cards, and it's for people that don't like multiplayer because, you know, you just play, you know, like normal Magic, one-on-one, 20 life, all that kind of stuff. So that's going to do it for this one. I want to remind you about the ChannelFireball.com buy list. That means that if you want to, say, start building your Canadian Highlander deck, here's a great way to do it. Take those draft rares or those junkers that you have from a deck that you don't play anymore and trade them into CFB. They'll give you 30% back if you trade them in for store credit, and you can use them for singles for Canadian Highlander and for whatever you want, your standard deck, whatever. And 30% bonus is legit. Like, that turns that pile of rares into something that is quite valuable. And you can get, again, you can get sealed product or whatever you want, or you can just get money too. So either way, make sure you check that out. If you like the video, make sure that you give it a little thumbs up down there, and you can subscribe to more. And also, I want to ask you, does this type of video interest you? Right? Because I like this format a lot, but if you're kind of looking at this like, I'm not going to play this. Why am I watching this format? Fair enough. I'll probably do them occasionally, but if you like it, let me know too. And, you know, cause I can do more of them. I'm kind of trying to do a little feeler here with CFB and seeing if these things are something that people want to see or if it's something that they'd rather not. So let me know, and I will adjust accordingly. Thanks for hanging out. We'll see you next time.